I hate theater. Oh, well, it's so disappointing, isn't it? You know what I do when I'm sitting in a darkened theater waiting for the show to begin? I pray. Dear God, please let it be a good show. And let it be short, oh Lord in heaven, please. 2 hours is fine, 3 hours is too much. And keep the actors out of the audience, God. I didn't pay good money to have the fourth wall come crashing down around my ears. I just want a story and a few good songs to take me away. I just want to be entertained. I mean, isn't that the point? Amen. You know, there was a time when people sat in darkened theaters and thought to themselves, oh, what have George and Ira Gershwin got for us tonight? Or can Cole Porter pull it off again? Can you imagine? Now it's please, Elton John, must we continue with this charade? Hey, it used to be sitting there in the dark, and you, as soon as the show would begin, you'd be transported to a world full of color and music and glamour. And you thought to yourself, my God, when are they going to bring up the lights? Oh, how things have changed. Hello. How are we this evening?
Good.
Good.
Oh, good. Well, I'm feeling a little blue myself, you know. A little anxious for no particular reason. A little sad that I should feel anxious at this age, you know. You know, a little self-conscious anxiety resulting in non-specific sadness. A state that I call blue. Well, anyway, when I'm feeling this way, blue, I like to listen to my music, so I woke through my records the other day. Yes, records. And I was about to put on the soundtrack recording to Meredith Wilson's The Music Man. I had a craving for a young Ronnie Howard. But then I said, no, let's have a treat. Let's escape for a while into the decadent world of the 1920s. When the champagne flowed and the caviar chilled and the whole world was a party. Well, for the wealthy, anyway. And so I dug about, what did I find but the soundtrack recording to one of my favorite shows, Gable and Stein's The Drowsy Chaperone. Remember? Music by Julie Gable, lyrics by Sidney Stein. Well, it's a two-record set remastered from the original recording. Well, it's the whole show with the original cast, including Beatrice Stockwell as the chaperone. Oh, isn't she elegant? And that was a full 15 years before she became Dame Beatrice Stockwell. Here, let me read the back to you. It says, mix-ups, mayhem, and a gay wedding. Well, the phrase gay wedding has a different meaning nowadays. But back then, it just meant fun. And that's just what this show is. Fun. So, would you indulge me? Would you let me play the record for you now?
Yes.
Oh, I was hoping you'd say yes. You hear that static? I love that sound. To me, that's the sound of a time machine starting up. All right, now let's visualize. Imagine, if you will, it's November 1928, and you're standing outside of the doors of the Morosco Theater, New York, and it's very cold. Remember when it used to be cold in November? Not anymore. November's the new August. It's global warming. We're all doomed anyway. It's very cold, and there's a heavy gray snake falling from the sky, but you don't care because you're about to see a Broadway show. Now listen. Isn't this wonderful? All right, now, can you close your eyes? Overtures. Overtures are out of style now. I miss them. It's the show's way of welcoming you. Hello, welcome. The meal will be served shortly, but first, would you like an appetizer? That's what an overture is, a musical appetizer. A poo-poo platter of tunes, if you will. Ah, oh, something new. Sounds like a dance tune. kind of frolicking. Maybe involving pirates. Oh, don't worry, there are no pirates. Don't you just love this? Okay, now here it is. The moment when the pirates start to
I don't know.
don't even know what that means. Okay, now I'm going to lead you through the record as best I can. And don't worry, it won't be hard to follow. So we begin with a welcome from the love-struck group.
Well, I just wanted to thank you all for coming. I tell you, I must be some lucky fellow. Why, who would have thought that I, Robert Martin, would be marrying a glamorous showgirl? And that glamorous showgirl would be willing to give up a successful career for me, Robert Martin. Now, if it weren't for prohibition, I would say, let's raise a glass.
Hear, hear.
To Miss Janet Vandegraaff, the most beautiful girl in the world.
Absolutely not!
Excuse me? The groom mustn't see his bride on the day of the wedding.
It's bad luck.
I hope you heard that, because that's the plot. So, basically, hang on for the ride.
Breakfast will be served in the Arabian room.
Wait. Say, it's a little early in the day to be drinking, isn't it?
I don't understand the question.
Look, just keep Janet away from Robert, you understand? You're the chaperone, that's your only job.
I'm on Capitan. Oh, Robert, who's my little monkey?
I am, I'm your little monkey.
So with the bride and groom whisked away, we turn our attention now to the B-plot, which involves the producer.
Mr. Fountain!
Getting married and leaving show business?
Mr. Fountain!
But doesn't she know I got obligations?
Mr. Fountain, I can be your leading lady! You're sitting yourself! I'm useless in the chorus!
The last time, you ain't got what it takes!
But I've been taking lessons, singing, acting, ballet.
Ballet?
Yeah, I'm pretty good too! Last week I auditioned for Swanee Lake.
A little annotation. The Kitty and Felton were a couple in real life. A Jack and Sadie Adler. Now here's a familiar comic construct. The stupid woman and her long-suffering companion. Well, of course she only appears stupid, but then she does something clever in the end that makes everyone question whether it's all an act. Well, the irony here is that Sadie was actually quite stupid. Jack had to explain all of the jokes to her, apparently. But still, she had a wonderful career on the stage. You know, at that time, theater was the only place where stupid people could earn a decent living. That was before reality television, of course.
Kitty, I don't got time for this.
Cup of tea for Mr. Fell.
No.
Have some nice profiterole. Boys, I'm not hungry.
Then maybe we can give you something else that you want.
Yeah, something that ain't food.
What?
You're confused as to be expected. Although we stand here before you in the guise of innocent pastry chefs, we are also...
And primarily?
Employees of a certain individual.
A certain individual?
A certain individual.
Who happens to be the largest single investor in Feldzeek's Folly. He has sent us here...
As pastry chefs.
To express his concern about Miss Vandegraaff's impending nuptials.
Specifically?
That if she gets married and leaves the show...
Then there ain't no show.
Hey!
No, you don't.
Have you ever spent any time in Toledo?
Have you ever spent any time in a coma?
No, but I have a cousin in Seattle.
Kitty!
Boys, you tell your boss that this wedding ain't never gonna happen. You have my word.
Oh, we'll take your word, all right.
Yeah, but to go back on that word would be a recipe for disaster. Now, I hope we have made ourselves perfectly eclair.
One can only hope.
You've just got to be kidding me.
A trifle much?
Don't talk with me.
All right! You can drop the pastry chef routine.
Hey, alas, we can ash.
We're on the land.
Land's an entree, you macaroon.
The gangsters were played by interchangeable vaudeville duo, the Tall Brothers, John and Peter Tall. Well, they were born Abram and Mendel Maslowskiewicz, but were renamed at Ellis Island by a half-sarcastic immigration official. They were the early example of the typical Broadway gangster, full of wordplay and stylized movements, not very intimidating. Well, unless, of course, if you find dancers intimidating, which, well, I do, but for reasons that would not be appropriate to the situation.
Anyway, leave the matter on hands, Mr. Feltic. In the meantime, feel free to browse the dessert carousel.
Try the Toledo surprise.
It's to die for!